How's it going, everybody? Andrew here from ISC Suspension North America, and today we're over at our shop and we're going to be installing our N1 coilovers on this S197 Mustang. We're going to go over some useful tips and tricks in regards to how to put these on this specific chassis, and we're going to go over some of the key features as well about these coilovers. So it's a monotube damper that comes standard with front adjustable camber plates and 32-way adjustable rebound dampening. These springs are linear and metric front and rear with a 65mm ID, so they are compatible with our Triple S upgraded coilover springs as well. Front end links are standard with this kit. This is our Street Sport kit, so this comes standard with an 8kg front and 5kg rear. Our track race dampener also is offered with a significantly higher spring rate for track specific vehicles. So while we have these off the car, we're going to preload the fronts 5mm. And we're going to anti-seize the front and rear shock bodies. We have to wait on preloading the rear because it's a separate spring perch design on a solid rear axle, so it's going to be done while we're actually doing the install. So let's get started putting things in, and we'll go over some of the features associated with putting them on an S197 Mustang. Check your box thoroughly, because we do now include anti-seize with the coilovers. You're more than welcome to use your own traditional parts store provided, but we do include it now. We're going to preload them. It's just easier to do. You can do it while it's on the car, but since we have them out here, we'll show you how to do it. So spring preload is separate from ride height on our coilover design. So the nice thing about that is when you go lower, ride quality stays consistent. On some different designs where the spring tension is actually controlling how high or low you want the car, the lower you go, the more drastic your ride quality is going to deplete. So right now we have our ride height here. This is locked. So later on when we adjust it on the car, we're going to be releasing this collar and utilizing this threaded shock body to thread in or out of the bottom out. That's what's going to bring the car up or down. But right now, for preload purposes, in the front at least for this car, we're basically going to set it and forget it. So we're going to go for 5mm of preload. That's what we recommend. So I had both of these collars loose out of the box here from the factory. So we're going to compress this spring right now. One useful trick in terms of measuring your preload is the distance that starts to happen here between these two locking collars is 5mm is actually the same width as the spanner tool. So as soon as we can fit the spanner in there, we know we're at 5mm. So we're gonna give it a couple more turns and check again. And there we have it. So that's 5mm of preload. We're gonna bring the secondary collar up and we are gonna lock it in place. So now we have 5mm of preload set on the coilovers.
So the first thing we're gonna do is take the sway bar end links off. It's easiest to do with everything still attached. The Ford end links are kind of cool because they have a box end and wrench on the inside, which makes it a lot easier. It's a 17 on this side and a 19 on this side. I'm gonna get the 17 in there and then... easy as that. So the next bolt you want to get is this little guy back here that holds the brake line onto the strut. It's a 10mm. I recommend doing this with a hand wrench, even though you can get an impact gun on it, only because this car is a 13, so I expect it's going to come out easy. But on earlier cars, this has probably got some rust on it, so you're going to want to feel it out. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to disconnect the strut from the spindle. It is a 18 on the inside and a 21 on the neck. Same with the lower one. These later cars, they're actually splined in, so you have to hit them with a hammer. So to get the splined ones out, I recommend throwing the nut back on, threading it most of the way on, and then hitting it with the hammer. And that takes the spline out, which will then let you remove the bolt. And it's the same situation on the bottom one. Bolt on. Good. and then it comes right out. You gotta usually gotta lift the spindle a little bit to get the last bolt out. And then it comes apart. So at this point, everything on the bottom is done. All you have to do is just connect the bolt to the top. I guess there is a ABS wire that's connected right here that I'm gonna have to pull off.
So to get this off, best thing to do is you don't want to pinch the ABS wire. But you do want to pinch the connector for the ABS wire and just kind of give it a yank out. These do break pretty easily, so you're going to want to work it a little bit. It will come out without damaging it if you take your time. Now we're actually 100% free. All I have to do is the top.
The top, there are four bolts. The real trick to this is doing three of them and then waiting to do the last one until you've got a hand on the strut. Now that you have three of them done, reach down and grab the strut, hold it up, it's pretty heavy. Drop the coilover right out, ready to go.
So Rob's gonna make these snug here on our camber plate adjustment with these 5mm Allen keys, because the opening on the OEM strut top for this specific chassis is pretty tight. So there are some aftermarket kits you can purchase to open that up more, but just to be safe right now, we're going to adjust this camber just in the neutral position and install it up there, just in case we can't access the Allen heads later on because of how tight the strut top is on the factory Mustang.
Slide it through, then hold it in place and put a nut on. On this particular application, I have an aftermarket strut bar that utilizes some washers to make it easier for me to install this. I'm just threading a couple of them without the washers so it'll hang. And then the other two, I'll start with the washers if you happen to be in this same situation. And once you get the two with the washers in place, and then you can add the washers on the two that you skipped washers on. Obviously, I just use the impact gun. Torque specs on these are pretty low. I just spun them down. I did not tighten them with the gun. So with the aftermarket end lengths that we supply, there's two things you need to know about. Is unlike the Ford ones, there is not a nut on the backside here, which is pretty industry standard actually. And then these are adjustable, and they are adjustable like this too. There is no top or bottom, they're symmetrical. I do recommend installing the bottom first, and then leaving it loose until the rest of the installation, just because right now you have a lot more room to work with tools in here, which you're going to lose if you do it later. So we're gonna slide it in here, and then we're gonna put the nut on. I, similarly to how the Ford ones are, will use a small vice grips here. When you do that, you gotta be very careful not to rip the boot. That's just part of the installation. When you put the vice grips on, make sure you push it all the way against this way around length, and then you want the vice grips as close to the bar as possible, as far away from the boot. You tighten those down, and it's still gonna be very loose. And then similarly to when we took it apart, it obviously cannot put an impact gun back there. So you need to ratchet wrench it. So now that is ready, and it will be facing this way when it comes back through the other side. I'm gonna leave it over here for now. The next step is gonna be reattaching the spindle to the strut. Just be aware that when you're doing this, the sway bar position can get in the way. We did the other side previous to this side, and we realized that we could not actually put this back on without disconnecting the sway bar. So you're probably gonna have to do that as well. Now I put this in backwards just because it was easier to get it in there. And then we're gonna put this one in the correct direction, and the nuts face forward. So on the ISC coilovers, we actually have a little bit of camber adjustment here. on most street cars, you're gonna want this all the way this way, because as you lower the car, you're gonna gain camber in just lowering the car. And on a street application, you're probably gonna wanna reduce that on this end. So by sliding the bolt all the way this way, you will do the best to counteract the camber that you're gonna gain when you lower the car. Bottom. The brake line connection is up here. It's a little higher because most of the cars are lowered. And then the brake wire connector is in the same place as it was. Okay, so on the factory Ford strut, this bolt goes into a blind hole, meaning that the component it goes into actually does not have threads until the bolt goes into it. Our setup is the same way. I've already tested this one to make sure it works, but you're gonna wanna, before you put the line in, you're gonna wanna put the bolt in place, pull your fingers, take your impact gun, push and pull the trigger, and it will make its own threads. Once it does, pull it back out, put the brake line up. Really hard to do left-handed. And now that the threads are actually in there, the only thing you need to know is that only works with the factory bolt. If you use any other bolt, it's not going to make its own threads. So on this, you may need to do the same thing that we did with the bottom and use the vice grips to tighten the to hold it. So it's now tight. So the adjustment on this adjustable end link is so that you can keep the sway bar level or as close to level as possible depending on your setup. So once you have the car fully assembled and your ride height set, at that point you want to come in here and take a look and see whether your bar is angled up or angled down. You can adjust this to compensate for it. So as you can see, as I'm loosening this, the bar is moving down, and as I tighten it, the bar moves up. So depending on your setup, you're going to set it in place, and then you're going to, like I said, one of these is a right-hand thread and one of them is a left-hand thread. You're going to tighten up the nuts. I'm going to do this work lowered on the ground so that we can show people how to do it who may not have a lift. But if you have a lift, we're going to need to disconnect the strut, which is going to make this whole axle drop. So you're going to want to support it with something on the axle. So that it can't drop too far, and you're probably going to need to be able to adjust that. So you're looking at like a transmission jack or an exhaust jack or something like that that's adjustable after we loosen the bolt. Okay, so now we've got the car down, more realistic to what most people are probably going to be doing. It's still on the jack, on the lift, but this could easily be on jack stands in this position. The front of the car wouldn't need to be jacked. It would actually give you even more clearance. Really, the trick to this is you're going to have to do both sides at the same time. And you're going to have the car lifted off the ground, and then you're going to have a jack lift up the back end. So when you're working on the car on the jack stands, you want to have it lifted up to the point not to the point where you're going to come off the jack stands, obviously, but you're going to want to have the rear end back up while you're taking it apart. I already loosened this one, but there's a trick to this. You put your gun on it, you loosen it up. The Ford makes these sweet little things that lock everything in place. So once you get that loose, a lot of times you'll go to take it off and it'll just spin and spin and spin. And you can push it a little bit, but then you can't get it the rest of the way. Use an open-ended wrench and just push it the rest of the way out that way. Well, when you're lowering the car down, the first thing that's going to hang, I think I could probably get the springs out right now, they're pretty loose. But just in case your suspension's a little tighter or whatever reason, when you're dropping the rear end, the first thing it's going to hang on is the brake line. So you may need to loosen the brake line just to let the rear end go down a little further. You may not have to, but it's something you should know. You just pull it right out. That easy. Okay, the rear shock bolt is behind this carpet, which is literally that loose from the factory. I didn't loosen anything. And you should be able to just hit it with a gun. So this is the factory bump stop. When you lower the car, a lot of times this will hit way too early. A lot of people online cut them down. So it kind of depends on how low you're lowering the car, how much you cut them down. There are also kits out there to relocate them and kind of change the bump stops completely. So that's kind of up to you. So the installation of the springs is pretty much identical as pulling them out. Just make sure everything's kind of clean a little bit before you do. You're going to want to keep the stock rubbers on the car. If you don't, they'll make noise.
So you should be able to just put that up and then put that there. So once you have the springs kind of laid in place, you're gonna jack the back end up until the springs touch the body. Right there, so now this is effectively being held in place. That's what you want. And next we'll install the strut. The first thing you wanna do when putting the strut back in is actually do the top. Sometimes this is easiest done with two people. You can have one person hold it up in place and have the second person put the bolt in place. Go ahead, Andrew. Okay, so now that we've got the suspension pushed back up a little bit more, you can see that the bolt hole lines up a lot better. And we're going to get the bolt through. And that is that. Now we have both the spring and the shock installed in place. And we just have to make adjustments from here. And obviously, if you took your brake lines off, make sure you put them back on.